One, two, Freddy's coming for you. Three, four, better lock your door. Five, six, grab your crucifix. Seven, eight, better stay awake. 9, 10, never sleep again.
The views expressed on the following broadcasts do not necessarily reflect those of KHLT, Take 12 Radio, or our affiliates. The opinions on this show should not be considered as medical, psychological, or professional advice and are those of the host, co-host, and guest. Take 12 Radio and KHLT Recovery Broadcasting are not affiliated with any particular 12-step fellowship.
God is a solution. God is a 12-step.
I like where he's going here.
Helps the community grow, helps us grow. Monty has done a phenomenal job. And you're talking about taking people through a spiritual process and getting them into recovery.
Thanks, Monty, and thanks for all your support.
We need spirituality to make this thing work long-term.
It's an absolute pleasure. He certainly knows a lot of people.
This is one of the places that is about the business of the solution.
And now, broadcasting on location somewhere in the vast expanse of the Pacific Northwest, it's the over-opinionated 12-stepologist, the Monty Man.
That's right. Greetings, one and all, and welcome to another episode of the Take 12 Recovery Radio Show. We are broadcasting to you and for you from the outskirts of beautiful downtown Albany, Oregon, via the internet. Our email address is take12radio@comcast.net. Our YouTube page is youtube.com/ Monty Meyer. And of course, you can download, subscribe for fun and for free on every major podcasting platform. Simply visit us at take12radio.com on your internet dial and subscribe there or wherever you get your podcast. All right. So this is day two of 2023. And I mean, when I see calendar dates and I see things like 1997, 2001, well, anything in the 90s particularly, I think, God, that was decades and decades ago, but it really wasn't that long ago. So 2023 doesn't even seem possible, but it is here. And I hope you had a safe, sober, and sane New Year's Eve and New Year. If you did not, I hope you're feeling better. In the studio with me this week is my good friend, Fred Allen, affectionately known as Freddy.
Hey, guys.
He is not the Freddy from Nightmare on Elm Street.
No.
But perhaps some of his antics at one time were nightmarish, and we're going to be talking about that. Fred is going to be sharing his experience, strength, and hope, what it was like, what happened, and what it's like today. But we like to have a little fun here before we start the show, so Cecil is in the box somewhere. There he is.
Stop right there, everybody.
Okay.
Because it's time for the Monty Man's weekly wine.
Mm.
All you do is wine. All you do is wine.
That's right.
All you do is wine. Wine. Whining is all you do.
That's right. This is the part of the show I get to whine about something I'm totally powerless over. And maybe I have some power. We're going to see. It's still in process. I'm going to pick on Amazon.
Amazon.
Yeah. Specifically Amazon Prime.
Prime.
Now, many of you, I mean, we just got done with the holidays, right? So many of you have taken advantage of the convenience of ordering online. Now, back in my grandparents' day, that's pretty much all the way they could order, but it wasn't online, of course. It was over the phone or through mail, snail mail, with Sears and Roebuck, Montgomery Ward, Macy's, Woolworth, that kind of thing. And they had catalogs. And you would open the catalog up and you would find out what you wanted to buy. And then you would send the check in the mail or you'd make a phone call. And like 3 to 4 weeks later, your item would come. And I'm sure that they ran into some of the difficulties that Amazon creates as well. Amazon Prime. So let me tell you, let me share with you what happened. So we have joined, Marcia and I have joined the ranks of smart homes to a degree. Not a huge degree, but we're like having some fun with it, right? So we got some smart plugs and, you know, Alexa, turn on Monty's lamp, you know, stuff like that. And she's talking at me again. She's in the office. So we decided to order a security system from Blink, which is an Amazon company. Excuse me. And so we ordered this system. And I fell in love with it, so I ordered a couple more cameras. And I ordered I'm not going to say it. We'll call it Alex, because if I say the name, then she's going to respond to me. An Alex Echo 8, and which is the larger screen, and you can access your cameras and all that kind of stuff. So I ordered it, along with a couple other Christmas gifts, and Amazon said it showed up. And so it showed up at the post office. So I went, and it wasn't at the post office. What's typical, though, is that they'll drop it off, they'll report that it showed up, and then you got to wait a couple days before it to hit your P.O. box, right? So we did that. It never showed up. So I checked with the front desk of the post office. Nothing from Amazon had come. Amazon claimed that it did arrive. So I contacted Amazon. And the very nice lady told me that she would cancel the order and she would resend the products, which she did. And within 2 days, everything shows up, right, on the second order. So I get that and I install the products and the other Christmas gifts we held off, of course, until Christmas. Shortly after that, the original product shows up. So now I have two of these Echo 8 things, right? And so I believe I should do the right thing. So I contacted Amazon. I said, the problem that occurred of it not showing up, it has showed up now. What do you want me to do with that? Do you want me to send it back to you? She said, well, hold on. And she checked and came back and she said, yes, we would like you to send it back and we'll send you a packing slip or whatever. I said, okay, fine, no problem. Within an hour, I got an email from Amazon stating, you do not need to send this back. It was our mistake. Keep it with our compliments and enjoy.
Wow.
Sure, fine. So a couple of days ago, I go to hook up the Echo 8 in here in the studio because we already have one in the house now, right? And it won't hook up. It won't register. So I called Amazon and a lady answered with broken English. And she says to me, well, yeah, that particular one, because it has a code on it, has been deactivated because you received a second one because that order was canceled. So it's been deactivated and it won't work. And I said, well, I have this letter sitting here that says I can keep it. Well, you can keep it. I said, but it's not doing me any good if I can't operate it. And she goes, well, that's our policy. You can keep it, but we deactivated it. I'm like, seriously? Here I'm trying to do the right thing. You guys are telling me it was your mistake. You know, for me to keep it. And then I go to use it and I can't use it because you've deactivated it. She goes, that's right. I said, so what am I supposed to do? Just throw it in the trash? She said, sure.
Wow.
So I have a second letter going to Amazon, and of course I get 3 emails back saying this email that you sent this to isn't the right one. you need to go to this link and this link and that, this and that. And all those links, they just take you to places where they have canned questions for you to answer. None of them fit my situation. So I'm at a dead end here. So I said, I sent another email. I said, I guess I'll use it as a paperweight. I hate to throw this away. Right. So there you go. There's my wine. What do you think, Fred?
Yeah.
What do you
know,
think about all that?
Amazon can be a godsend and, you know, double-edged sword, I guess. Right.
Right.
Yeah. So, you could get your item within 3 days, you know, hurrah, or we could have something like that take place. And it's like, now what?
Yeah. Yeah. So I am glad to send it back, but I'm not
sure.
I'm not going to pay for it to send it back.
Right.
But yeah. So I mean, they have been good. I mean, this is the first holiday season that we've actually ordered quite a few things from Amazon, and it was very convenient because who enjoys, you know, the parking lot madness going to Target or Walmart and all that stuff. Right.
Right.
I don't enjoy that. Although I will say, I'm not the humbug at Christmas time that's mad because people are shopping. I'm like, look, where else do you get really cool music, beautiful lights and decorations, and everything's half price? I think that's pretty cool.
Yeah,
but yeah, well, whatever. And people say, oh, commercialization at Christmas. Everything's commercialized all the time, no matter what time of year. Anyway, so there's my weekly wine. That'll do it for that.
All you do is wine, wine. Whining is all you do.
All right, we'll be back with Fred's story.
As folks in recovery, do you ever feel like your circumstances are controlling the way you act, think, and feel? I mean, why can't other people just behave and grow up? If everyone would just look at life the way we do, all would be well, right? Yes, we have all felt this way a time or two, but what if this is a common issue? I mean, what if you're constantly being let down by others and you seem to get knocked off your emotional balance beam time and time again? Well, 12 Essential Insights for Emotional Sobriety, the brand new book by popular recovery author Dr. Alan Berger, will help you get unstuck from the emotional dependency that we can all fall into while working our recovery programs. In this book, you will learn the therapeutic value of self-awareness and recover your true self as you experience emotional sobriety. For an autographed copy of 12 Essential Insights for Emotional Sobriety, visit www.abphd.com. This book is also available on Amazon. Feeling stuck in your recovery? Why not get unstuck today with 12 Essential Insights for Emotional Sobriety?
He's insane. He's a control freak. So, what's your point? It's the Monty Man at take12radio.com on your internet dial.
Don't go to sleep.
Sleep.
All right. Welcome back to the show. This is the Take 12 Recovery Radio Show, the world's oldest and original recovery talk and recovery music radio station and podcast. And today on the show is my good friend, Fred Allen.
Hey, Monty. Hey, guys.
Yeah. So Fred, if you're watching on YouTube, there he is. Wait, Fred.
Hey, guys.
Hey. So Fred and I met, for lack of a better term, in a faith-based treatment program.
Yeah.
I was a director of education, and he came in as a student. And is now what we would refer to as an alumni of that particular program, which is titled Adult and Teen Challenge. And this was particularly, specifically here in the Pacific Northwest. You're an alumni of the Willamette Valley campus in Shedd, Oregon. And, that's a year program. It's, it, it's, It's extensive. It is faith-based. It also has a clinical side to it called Life Renewal. And you are, you look great.
Thank you.
You know,
Feel great.
You've got joy in your heart. You have a relationship with the God who is God, and you're doing the recovery thing. And it's an amazing thing to watch. But that wasn't always the case.
That wasn't always right? the case, Monty. No.
What was going on? What got you to a point where you felt like you needed to walk through the doors of, you know, a faith-based recovery program?
Man, so, you know, this is such a blessing to be here with you today, Monty. You know, you had told me a year ago that if I was to persevere through, you know, that you would have me on your show. And I really appreciate everything you've done
Absolutely,
for me.
Absolutely, man.
Yeah. So I'm 39 years old. I grew up in the San Bernardino Mountains of Southern California. Beautiful place. Good home. You know, my parents worked. Parents worked their butt off and always lived humbly and modestly.
Yeah.
You know, and I just completely took that for granted. I became prideful. I became, I got angry, you know, at times when I didn't get my way, you know.
Imagine that.
Yeah, shoot. And so my wife and I were married for 10 years. She went to school and I worked for the International Union of Operating Engineers. And she ended up getting her master's degree. And through that time, I had struggled on and off with using drugs. And, you know, I always was able to hold on just enough to get another day of another day, you know, with her, or actually to use her, if that may be the case. Mm. And she had finally had enough, you know, and I don't blame her. You know, I blamed her for a little while because I was, you know, felt shameful and guilty. And so she had ended up leaving me and we got a divorce. And it crushed me. Now I had an excuse to go full on out and go use, you know.
Because it's your fault.
Because right, exactly. Now I have someone to blame. And right. Exactly. And I couldn't take anything as an assertive manner in life. Yeah, so I ended up coming up here. I dropped out of the union. I came up here and I got completely lost and just saturated in drugs.
What brought you to Oregon though, all the way from Southern California?
Good question. Yeah. So my father had sold his company, the one that I would work for periodically when I could hold a job at the time.
Yeah.
Right. And he had sold his company and he moved up to a little place called Stevenson. Okay. And it's kind of up by Hood River, just on the Washington side. Mm-hmm. And he has a couple homes up there, and then he was building another one as a rental property. And, you know, when she had left me, I am an only child. I don't have any brothers, sisters. I don't even have any cousins, and I didn't know where to turn. So I had reached out to my dad for help, and he was more than willing to do that. He said, Fred, come on up. You know, I'm building a rental right now. You can come help me do that. Terrific. And that's exactly what I did. I learned so much through him, you know, just from literally the ground up. We built this place and it turned out great. And then I had made the decision to go get a real job, you know, to actually so I can make some money, get out on my own, because mm-hmm. I'm living under my dad's roof at the time. And I went to a place and I became a millwright. It was at a mill up there, up in Bingen, Washington. And I worked there as a millwright and I was doing pretty good, you know, getting into it. I was on the first shift, you know, and I was able to maintain that for about 8 months.
Were you staying sober or were you dabbling?
I was staying sober for about 7 months. Okay. And then around my eighth month, I started dabbling and they didn't know because I was a master manipulator, right?
Sure.
I was still able to kind of perform. And I had gotten a raise of a dollar. And I became so prideful and I was thinking I was worth so much more than that. I had literally ended up quitting, which was one of the biggest mistakes, you know, just another mistake that I had made. And I had gone and started using even more since I was dabbling. Now it was game on. I had lost my wife. Now I had lost my job and I didn't know what to do. Well, I resorted back to what I knew would comfort me, you know?
Yeah.
And so I ended up going from a 3-story house in Lake Arrowhead, California to a tent in on some island in Hood River.
Wow.
Now I wasn't even living with the homeless. I was living outside the homeless spectrum, right? I was like on this little island, 360 degrees of water, and using as much methamphetamine as I could. I didn't care about tomorrow. I didn't care about anything but getting high.
Where were you getting your meth if you're on this little piece of land?
So yeah.
You having it flown in? So
you're funny. So to get to this island, you would have to go about through maybe 30 feet of water.
Yeah.
The width of it, right? And it was maybe 4 feet tall, 4 feet high, about waist height.
Yeah.
So that's how I would cross back and forth. And now to get the meth, oh, it was bad money. So to get the meth, the neighbor, right, who is also homeless,
right,
would move just pounds and pounds of this stuff. So, you know, being in a predicament where I, of course, don't have a job now nor any money, I had asked him, hey, well, can I work for you? Can I do something for you to, you know, get these drugs? And he said, well, yeah, let's, you know, you can go out and go get it. You can be a runner, they call it, right? So I would go pick the drugs up, you know, the mule.
Right.
And I would bring them back to him and he would feed me drugs that way. So I like never ran out because this guy was kind of like a kingpin up there. It was just an ugly cycle, man. I remember sitting in this makeshift tent that I had made. I put 3 easy ups together and I stole some Tyvek from a construction company and I put the walls up like that. And then I had this tarp on top with a bicycle wheel on top to almost like a Barnum and Bailey's circus tent. You know, this is like a vaulted ceiling. And, yeah. So, and I remember one day, you know, I was doing my thing and I had this one lady come over like all the time. Right. We would get high and we would do our thing. And then she would leave like when I was finally passed out. So I remember one of these mornings where, well, she would steal my stuff as well. You know,
of course.
Yeah. It was just unbelievably horrible. And one morning I had woken up, or one afternoon actually, and she had stole the little propane heater that I had. And I'm like, are you kidding me? Like, this is how I keep warm. Cause it's kind of cold with, you know, 360 degrees of water around you. And I had, at that time, that's like what it took for me just to lose it. Right. And I was screaming and yelling and cursing and I had felt a feeling, the most powerful feeling I've ever experienced in a negative manner, and that's emptiness. I had felt so empty at the time. I had no one to turn to. I had burnt all my bridges, you know. I felt like the world was better off with me not in it anymore. Mm-hmm. You know, and that is such a polluted and distorted thought, you know, to think that the world is better if I was to commit suicide opposed to me living another day is so bad. It crushed me.
Yeah.
You know, it truly did. I would do things like, I would just do things so, what I wasn't taught, that isn't morally right. Like, my parents didn't teach me to do this. My parents taught me to be a stand-up person. They taught me to be, you know, assertive and take the bull by, you know, take the horse by the reins. And I did everything against what they taught me. And I was so depressed and so sad and feelings of shame and guilt, you know.
Which just fed, right, the thinking that you were having, that you were, you know, not worth anything. And it's a vicious cycle of just feeding that stuff.
It is. And it just progressively got worse.
Did you ever actually attempt to take your life?
No, I didn't have.
But you seriously considered it.
But I seriously considered it.
Yeah.
You know, I thought about ways to do it, but I never acted on it.
Yeah.
Thank God.
Yeah, thank God.
You know.
Right.
So I came now, I was at a place of just brokenness.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like I had said, I burnt every bridge. No one wanted me around. I couldn't even stand myself. All I could care about was how I was going to move the drugs for that one guy to enable me to get some more. The number one priority was to get high and have sex. That was what I lived for.
Yeah,
you know,
sure.
And it didn't matter what it took. So my priorities were so out of sync. I was not in touch with God. You know, I had always kept a Bible underneath my bed. Don't know why, but because I didn't open it, never opened it, but it was just for maybe a security reason, just in case, you know, a just in caser. And God has helped me persevere through this, even when I didn't believe in him, he continued to believe in me. So I was on a stolen bicycle, right? You know, I crossed this bike through this water, right? And I pushed it up this little hill, and that's how I got around. And I was on this stolen bicycle, and all of a sudden I was getting pulled over by a police officer. I'm like, wow, what the heck is going on here, right? Okay, so I pull over. And yeah, how can I help you, officer? And he says, you know, we just got reports of this bicycle being stolen. I said, well, how did that happen? You know, of course, you know, my manipulation, this thing isn't stolen, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
And so that lady that I was telling you about that I was hanging out with so much, who stole my heater, had it out for me. This woman called the cops knowing that that bike was stolen and telling, you know, letting them know what's going on.
Yeah.
Which inevitably was a blessing, because I had gone to jail then for 18 days in the Dalles, Oregon. And when I was in that jail, it gave me time to eat. It gave me time to sleep. It gave me time to sober up. Right. And the judge of NorCor said that I can do a 1 month drug and alcohol treatment center, or I can stay in jail for 90 days and free and clear to go.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I had told that judge, you know, I had lost everything. I have gotten myself to a point where I am empty and I am broken and I have nothing else to live for. So I don't think a month is going to do it. Would you be willing to give me a different option? And that's when I was presented with the year-long faith-based option of Adult and Teen Challenge. I took it. I absolutely, you know, full-fledged, let's do this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I need help.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I've never had God in my life before, and faith-based, well, I wasn't doing anything right anyways. So,
right.
You know,
yeah.
So how, yeah, it's worth a shot. You know, I jumped all over it, Monty.
How did you hear about this program?
You know what? It was actually in jail.
Oh, okay.
Yep. I was in there for the 18 days, and one of the guys in there had heard my options. You know, I had told him, I brought it back to the cell, and he told me about it. And then I called my dad. Now, my dad's girlfriend's son was in Adult and Teen Challenge that I didn't even know about. And he's like, yeah, well, hey, go to it. You know, let's give it a shot. It's working great for this guy.
Yeah.
You know, so, whoa, cool. That was kind of okay, let's do it. I've never had a brother before, you know, type of thing. And maybe we could help each other. So it was from two different people that I had heard this from. And best decision of my life. You know, I walked through the doors. I had an opportunity to, you know, to meet you. I think you did my intake.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what? You asked me, Monty, one of the most important questions that anyone has ever asked me before. And on December 13th, 2021, you asked me if I wanted to turn my life over to the hands of Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I looked you directly in the eyes. I said, yes, please. Let's do it. Man.
I remember that
so
well.
That was, gosh, Monty, you helped me transform into a better person with a bright future, and I appreciate that.
Yeah.
I truly do. Now, that wasn't the entire transformation.
Sure.
Right?
Rarely is.
Rarely is. That was the introduction to God.
Yeah.
And now I'm letting God work in me. Right. I let that door open up and let's see where this goes from there. So a few months later, I have Adult and Teen Challenge. You know, they do keep you active. It is challenging. It's 6 days a week. Go, go, go. You go to work, you go to Bible study, you go to Life Renewal. And Life Renewal teaches you, it gives you the ability to cope with your emotions. You know, because when we're out there, we only feel three things. When I was out there, I was doing drugs, and I would only feel three feelings, and that's angry, sad, and happy. Well, come to find out, there's more feelings than just that, right?
Yeah, right.
So these guys have taught me so much, and I would say about 3 to 4 months into the program, we all went up to a place called Medical Lake. And now that is 13 campuses from the Pacific Northwest,
mm-hmm.
and about 500 people. And we all met at this Medical Lake, which is in Spokane, Washington. And they had titled it Spiritual Emphasis.
Right.
Never been to anything like this before in my life. And I remember I was waiting for breakfast with one of the interns there, and it was just a normal compliment I had given this guy, you know, boom, wasn't expecting anything in return. And, just being a good guy and complimenting what I thought he had done correctly. Well, you know what his answer was, Monty? His answer was, it's not me. That's all God. And for some reason, this irritated me so bad. I wanted to jump over the table at this guy, right? Man. And I'm like, you can't even take a compliment from me. I'm thinking to myself.
Right.
And this is, and then I had to like analyze myself. Like, why am I so angry right now? Like, what is going on? And I had a spiritual advisor tell me one time, hey, Fred, do you use God with a G or a capital G? You know? And then he had also told me that it's either black or white, Freddie. You're either in or you're out. There's no gray area. You either believe every word in this book or you don't. It's that simple. Mm-hmm. And we still love you either way. It doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. So all of these little things started coming to me, and I'm like, wow, God is omnipresent. He's doing all of this. And that man responded for me so it can get through my heart. And this is like truly where the breakthrough was starting to happen. Mm-hmm. And I was like, wow. And that day, later that day, I made it a public announcement when I was dunked in Medical Lake and baptized. Man.
And that was a cold, cold day, wasn't it?
That was a cold day.
That was a cold day.
It was raining outside,
oh,
and I didn't care.
I remember
care.
That. Oh, it was, yeah. Yeah.
In front of 500 people, I made this public announcement. I was like, okay, cool. Now, man, what an opportunity, like, to get on board with Christ Jesus as my Lord and Savior and let the Holy Spirit work in me has literally helped transform the person I am. And just a blessing, you know. I had worked hard for myself, 14 challenge, and they had recognized that. I was blessed with an opportunity to go up to Alaska on the construction team. Man, oh man, what an opportunity. The sky was active with bald eagles. The land was active with deer. The water was active with fish. And now this man up there who we went and worked for, man's name's Ori Bell. He is a commercial fisherman, and he's building this resort on an island, 360 degrees of water. And I was a part, I had an opportunity to go work on that place for him. And that is how, you know, God, that's God's way of, that's God's humor. You know, he had showed me not but a year ago, I was on my own little island.
Right.
Working for Satan. And now I'm on this beautiful island in Alaska working with God, you know, working for God.
Wow.
What a change. What a transformation, man. It's been beautiful.
You know, while you were sharing, I was thinking of this paragraph in the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. It says, let no alcoholic or addict say he cannot recover unless he has his family back.
Mm.
Right? At a point in your transformation process, there was no guarantees there would be any reconciliation, right?
No, absolutely not.
None. It says, this just isn't so. In some cases, the wife will never come back for one reason or another. Remind the prospect, that's the new guy, that his recovery is not dependent upon people. It is dependent upon his relationship with God.
Amen.
So you've learned that. You've learned that your recovery, that's what it's dependent on.
Yes.
It's not dependent on meetings. It's not dependent. And you and I were at a great meeting the other night.
Yeah, got my 1 year chip.
You got your 1 year
yep.
chip.
Yep.
But if that meeting ceased to exist, you can still stay sober and clean, right?
That's right. That's right. You know, the steps that I have been taught
yeah.
is you put God first.
Right.
Okay. And then the second step is your recovery.
Right.
Third step, family, and then job. And that is the correct order. You know,
yeah.
I have
Amen.
To remember that. I have to remember that this is the correct order of how it's done, you know? And the fruits of the Spirit, like, I always go back to certain portions in the Bible where really help me, like, grasp and continue to hold on to the Holy Spirit. Fruits of the Spirit, because I've never been a patient person. You know, I've always wanted the instant gratification, right?
Right.
And so love, joy, kindness, discipline, self-control, obedience. Like, I'm learning all of these things, joyfulness. And every time I feel like acting out in my flesh,
mm-hmm.
I go back to the fruits of the Spirit and I'm like, okay, hold on, pause, be analytical, think about it before you make your next move. Because, you know, the flesh can grab you every now and then.
It's oh, yeah. Like, it's,
yeah. Yeah. There, you know, fork in the road. Freddie wants to go right and the Holy Spirit wants you to go left. And that little feeling you get inside your heart or your stomach, you know, that's him talking to you. So we got to, I got to be mindful of that.
It goes on to say, if you persist in what? In your process of applying and implementing these spiritual disciplines, it says, remarkable things will happen. When we look back, we realize that the things which came to us, when we put ourselves in God's hands, were better than anything we could have planned.
Amen. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. And that's just it, right? So I had left the Left Teen Challenge just recently, you know, 12 months in the program, and I had gone over to a homeless shelter for the night. Well, what I had packed in my backpack, because I was homeless before, I know you need to be able to move.
Right.
What I had packed was some beef jerky, you know, some almonds, and my Bible. Now, that was another like breakthrough for me.
Right.
I'm like, okay, you know, what am I going to do here? I don't have any money. I don't have a bank account. I don't have a cell phone. I don't have a food card.
Right.
You know, it's like, whoa. So, being able to pack that Bible was good for me. It was huge. It was like, okay, so this is the faith. This is like Benaiah in 2 Samuel. It's like Benaiah in 2 Samuel where that man was, what, King David's right-hand man, mm-hmm. right? And he, like, operated off faith. You know, he didn't let fear hold him back, right? I mean, this man jumped in a pit with a lion while it was snowing out to kill this thing, right? And, man, and he did. Now, mind you, a lion, you know, those things can jump like 15, 20 feet.
Sure.
There's no way we go hand to hand with one of these guys and be able to take him down. Well, Benaiah operated off faith and he did. And I took from that, you know, I took that faith and I was like, okay, so what do I need to do? I need to be proactive. And God had blessed me the very next morning with a man named John. And John runs a place called God Gear. And it's for people getting out of treatment. You know, and to get them and, you know, enable them to get back on their feet. And man, within 3 days, I had my Social Security card back because I had lost it. You know, I had the food card, I had the phone, And I had a place to stay with 1 month paid.
Right.
What a blessing. Right. What a blessing, man.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. And I have a bank account started up. He had let me make, you know, a few bucks from him, by working for him, you know, and things are just falling into place. And even though I don't have much of anything, you know, I have a relationship with God. I have a driver's license. And you know, that's literally, I literally have a better feeling now than I did when I had, you know, the three-story house, when I had all these monetary things. You know, a car would be nice, super nice, because, you know, my legs can get tired, but, yeah. But you know, it's coming.
Yeah.
It's coming, you know, and I get an opportunity to go back to Alaska at the end of March and get on that gentleman's fishing boat.
Yeah.
Man.
Wow.
God is good.
Yeah. That is amazing. Now wow. I want to rewind for just for a minute.
Okay.
John is John Phelps.
John Phelps,
referring to. Yeah. And the organization that he's also a part of is Chance,
mm-hmm.
right? And I just want to give a shout out to them. Chance integrates short-term goals with long-term goals so individuals have a better chance of becoming productive members of our community. Their goal is to demonstrate commitment by applying spiritual principles. Now, listen, if you are in the Willamette Valley, Linn County, Benton County, Lane County, and you'd like to get a hold of Chance, you can give them a call at 541-791-3411. And they certainly have helped you. We have worked with Chance. We have a relationship with Adult and Teen Challenge and Chance and John.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Great guy, doing great work. And, you know, God bless the sober living homes of God Gear and Oxford and all those guys. And so what I hear you saying is you put one foot in front of the other, you did the next right thing. And this time when you carried your Bible with you, it was a different relationship with it, wasn't it?
It was.
It wasn't
different.
Just tucking it under your mattress,
right?
As a security blanket, or
I used it as a sword.
You used it as a sword.
Like I literally used this thing, you know, which comforted me and counseled me through all of it,
right?
You know, because I could have very easily, you know, just like any of us, you know, I had got that 1 year chip the other night, right?
Yeah,
which was super cool.
And you'd never done that.
Never done that before.
Right.
No. No, which was awesome. Very encouraging. But then I had said that, you know, I was in a bubble, right? In Adult and Teen Challenge.
Sure. You were in a controlled environment.
I was in a controlled environment. Yeah. Yep. They told me what to do. I did it, and I did it as best as I could.
Sure.
Now that I have moved on from there and I'm now, you know, out in the real world.
Yeah.
Right. So now the real work begins. And yes. That's exactly what I have been taught too.
Absolutely. Now the recovery begins.
Yes.
That's treatment. This is recovery.
That's right.
And that's the common denominator of people that keep coming back into treatment when they really don't, I mean, I'm going to get in trouble for this, but they really don't need that. They need to apply the principles that they learned while in treatment and apply them out in the real world. You know, and get plugged into a recovery fellowship, be of service, trust God, clean house, help others.
That's right.
And follow the directions. And if they'll do that, not only will they stay clean and sober, but they will become productive members of society, and they will develop a relationship with the divine.
Mm.
And they won't have to come back into a treatment environment over and over and over again, depending on the treatment center to fix their problems.
Right.
Because we've said it at Adult Teen Challenge before, right? A million times. This will not fix you.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, the real work begins. Having faith and trust in God with everything, like that guy had angered me about at Spiritual Emphasis right before I had the breakthrough. He was so right. Like,
yeah,
it's what you have to do. And the Holy Spirit, like, dwells in us, Monty. I can, you know, I'm absolutely able to recognize it now, right? Like, it pushes me in a good direction. And, you know, I'm able to come on your show. I'm able to, you know, do all of these good things. And people are more than willing to help, you know, if I'm willing to help myself. And, you know, I'm going to get to a place, Monty, where I'll be able to have an assertive stance in life. You know, it'll be, you know, I had the rug pulled out from under me. And when that happens, you know, it's a free ride for a little while, you know, but when that happens, now what? I mean, you know, so now, no matter what it takes, no matter, I think I just had to get humble. It's going to be my rug, you know? So the only one that could ever pull that out from under me would be me.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Did you ever think in a million years that you would be the kind of person that would be so bold and have no problem giving Jesus Christ the credit for your life, like you did the other night at that 12-step meeting?
Man, there had been so many radical changes in my life. I was the guy that had looked at the person on the street and was like, what the heck? Like, how does that even happen? You know, and then to be able to empathize with that man now,
right?
You know, because I have lived there, I've done it, and to take Christ into my life, pull out of it with Christ, it's unbelievable. I'm taught that I have to take in, I have to receive, and I have to give as well.
Yeah.
So I have to do what I did the other night at the 12 step and being able to share what I'm doing right now and being able to share what God has done in my life. So then I can get filled back up again by Jesus.
Yeah.
You know, it's like the revolving. Amen. Yeah. It's like change. You don't want to like, so yesterday in church, the pastor was talking about like pouring in salt into a salt shaker. Right. And then it'll fill up. And if you don't give it away, if you don't pour it back out, then you can't fill back up. And he was trying to say, you know, we receive all of these blessings from Christ and we're taking these things in, we're filling our cups up, but in order to get more, we're going to have to give it away. And that's being a disciple.
Yeah. You can't fill up a full cup.
Right. Right. Exactly. Yeah, you got to pour some out and give it away. It's worthless.
We have to be emptied.
Right.
Yeah, we have to be emptied. And most of, because I'll fill up with me.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And I've heard people say, well, wait, you know, the oil is representative of the Holy Spirit in many times, either two ways. It's either a reference of the Holy Spirit or it's a reference of a healing salve, right? A medical thing.
Sure.
In the Bible. And so, but I'll hear people say, I want more of the Spirit. I want more of the Spirit. I want more of the Spirit. And God's saying, well, you need to have less of you, less of you, less of you.
Well said.
You know, you can't put more oil in a container that's filled with you.
Yeah.
You've got to empty yourself. And then the good stuff that does come in, you're right. You have to constantly give that out if you want to keep renewing
it. Exactly.
Yeah. And so it's like, you know, where's the Spirit? Where's the Spirit? Where's the Spirit? Well, where are the vessels? Right? Where's the empty vessels?
That's right.
You know, that's right. But no, I really appreciated the way you shared your experience, strength, and hope the other night at that 12-step meeting, because you didn't you were specific about who God was, you named Him by name, but you said it in a general way as applied to your situation. You weren't trying to make converts, you weren't trying to proselytize anybody or any of that. You were just sharing your truth in that, and it came across beautifully. It
good.
Really, really did.
Good.
And I think sometimes people are afraid to do that because people have said things like, we're not specific about who our higher power is here in this meeting. Well, according to the big book of AA, if it's an AA meeting, and these guys were specific.
Yeah.
They were specific. People need to read page 11 in the big book where Bill Wilson is talking about his bad attitude towards Jesus. And how he learned that he was wrong in having that attitude. But people need to share, you know, their experience. How am I going to know what is working for you? Nothing's working for me. How am I going to know how this is working for you unless you're specific? And you were. And
thank
I think
you.
I think you did it beautifully. I wish more people would have the boldness to do that. And I think people that have had a radical change in their life, it's very difficult to hold back from sharing that.
Yeah, it seemed to flow. Like, I was nervous, you know.
It flowed beautifully.
But it just flowed. I was like, whoa.
Yeah.
And it was all 100% truth, you know, and it's...
And people that get offended by that, they walk around offended all day long anyway, so you don't have to worry about it.
Yeah.
Okay, so your plans right now,
mm-hmm.
right, on a day-to-day basis, is to do what?
So I don't have much money. I was able to put a couple $100 in a bank account the other day. So, and I don't want to continue to pull off of, you know, try to get another free month. You know, I want to be proactive.
Right.
So I need some capital somehow. And I'm willing to work. The guys at the house, I had taken over one of the gentleman's chores. He gave me $20. Cool. Now I can get a haircut. Right.
Yeah, yeah.
So this gentleman named Bear is a part of the God Gear.
Yeah, he's actually the property owner, isn't he?
He's the property owner.
Of the house that you live in.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Now he's the one that had given me a couple $100 the other day to do some work around the house for him. Well, I spoke to him last night and he wants me back.
Nice.
Yeah. Yeah. So tomorrow I'm gonna be working for him over at the property right next door that he owns as well.
Mm-hmm.
And so that is cool. That is good. And he also had told me, now there's a place around here, they do some construction. Not the most optimal thing for me to do, but it's probably the best paying for the time, and I'm good at it. So I'll be able to go possibly get a job with them.
Cool.
Yeah, and just stay proactive.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, because I, you know, it can be challenging, you know.
So
but
you're taking care of business.
I'm taking care of business.
You're doing it.
Yeah.
I'm going to pick you up for the meeting Friday again.
Yay.
Right?
Yay. Yep.
And so you're putting one foot in front of the other and doing the next right thing. Long-term goal. What's your long-term goal?
Okay, so this is the fun part.
Yeah.
So my long-term goal would be a commercial fisherman in Alaska. Now, I know that these boats out there, most of them, let's say, aren't clean boats. These guys are using on them.
Yeah.
Okay. And I was blessed with that trip up there to work directly for Ori. And I had spoke to him maybe a month ago, 3 weeks ago to a month ago by now. Mm-hmm. And he had said, you know, when it defrosts up here, Freddie, probably about the end of March, then you can come on up and you can work directly for me. And my heart dropped. I had a tear come down my eye, you know, roll down my cheek. And it's like, yes.
Yeah. And this is a godly man.
This is a godly man.
Who runs a clean ship.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is rare. Which is cool. It's
yeah.
Very cool.
What yeah. a blessing. Yeah.
Yeah.
And now he has gotten saved the capital from this boat. He's about 71 years old. He saved the capital from this boat and invested it and does whatever he does. But he was able to start a 5-star resort on this island that I had been talking about, Admiralty Island. And it's like 90% done. So with some of my carpentry skills, when the off season comes, right, from the fishing, because I think mm-hmm. you only fish about 6 months out of the year for halibut and cod. When the off season comes, I'm pretty sure he'll want me to go work on the resort, you know, and that will get me through for the next couple years, I'm hoping, you know. So I have a pretty good idea of what I'm going to be doing for the next couple years.
Now, is the plans for that resort to actually become an adults and teen challenge facility?
You know, I don't know that for 100% fact. That's what it seems
like
to me.
There's some chatter about that.
Yeah.
Though, right? Yeah.
Yeah. This man is, you know, like you, got a big heart, uh-huh. humble. Well, it's true.
Oh,
yeah. And always wants the best for other people. So like I had said, this guy's about 71 years old and he, this is like a big resort. It's like 5 stars. It's maybe 20,000 square feet. Each room has a loft that goes up in it. There's a big boiler room downstairs. I mean, there's, you know, washing machines. It's bad. It's nice.
Yeah.
And now he lives maybe, I don't know, in Petersburg, which is, I'm not sure how far away that is, a couple hundred miles maybe.
Yeah.
And he wants to, I'm pretty sure he wants to give this thing to Adult and Teen Challenge, just donate it somehow, or at least let the guys come up and get in touch with, you know, God in a manner where it's just
away from big city distractions from,
exactly,
and all that stuff. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. So yeah. I'm not exactly sure how that's going to work, but I know Teen Challenge is incorporated with it somehow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah. So cool. I'll be able to hopefully work there and give back too, you know.
I told you this hour would go by fast. It's almost over.
That's awesome.
Isn't
yeah.
that wild?
Yeah, that is wild, man. Thank you so much for having me on your show, Monty.
So before we go to our closing song for this week, any last thoughts for those who may be listening? Keeping in mind that our listenership includes friends and families of people that are not in recovery that maybe need to be, friends and families of people that are, okay. People that have recovered from a seemingly hopeless state of mind and body, people that are still working on it, right? And advocates of that is our audience base.
Okay.
What are your closing thoughts for them?
So for the guys that are out there, for the men and women that are out there struggling, broken, empty, have nowhere to turn but back to a syringe, back to a pipe, back to, you know, what they know to numb them out.
Yeah.
Muster up the courage somehow to turn your life over to God, because God will truly transform you. And it's not an easy step, you know, and you have to be willing to grab the bull by its horns and go get some help. This, you know, these, there's so many good people out there. When I was out there, I didn't know any good people. Everybody I knew was a crook. You know, everybody I knew was out to get you somehow or get mm-hmm. something from you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I know that feeling, and it sucks so bad
yeah.
to live in that garbage, that satanic world. But there are people out there that will open the doors so you can get some help. And there is more life ahead of you than what you think.
Mm.
You know, the world will become a better place with you in it than it was, you know, than my distorted thought pattern before.
To be without you in the world.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Get hooked up into a church is a great place to go. The churches love us, right? They,
Churches have come a long ways from their lack of understanding addicts and alcoholics
mm-hmm.
to a much clearer picture of us.
Yeah.
And I give a lot of that credit to organizations like Celebrate Recovery, Alcoholics for Christ, Alcoholics Victorious, Adult and Teen Challenge, Salvation Army, Victory Outreach, these faith-based groups that have introduced the church to folks like you and I,
mm-hmm.
you know, and because get, you know, because people for years have said, well, I don't want a treatment center in my neighborhood.
Right.
I don't want those people in mine. They already are in your neighborhood.
Yeah. It's just doing the wrong thing.
It's your paper boy. It's yeah. your kid, for crying out
sure.
loud.
Sure. Sure.
Yeah. So I think the church yeah. has come a long way and is doing well in that
yeah.
area.
Absolutely. And you know, my mom has always tried to steer me towards believing in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
She has gotten me this beautiful necklace for Christmas.
That's nice. Yeah.
Right. I mean, I don't really wear necklaces. This is not my style, but this yeah. thing is bad. So, you know, I want to thank my mom for never giving up on me. I have crushed her in many ways. You know, I'm the only child, and I want to let you know, Mom, that it's not your fault the way I made my poor decisions. You guys, you know, my family did a great job raising me, and they really taught me the right way to do things, which I'm now doing.
Yes, you are. Yes, you are.
So God bless you, Mom. I love you.
Oh,
I truly
great.
Do.
Freddie, thank you so much, man.
Monty, I appreciate you having me on your show. You know, You introduced me to Christ. Thank you.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's awesome. Yeah, he gave me goosebumps.
Amen.
All right. Well, there we go, folks. Another show sharing with you the experience, strength, and hope of my good friend Freddie and Fred Allen, to be specific. Living a life at one time, much like a nightmare on Elm Street, but now living a life that is glorifying heaven and the God who is God. And so we look forward to watching what God's got in store for you, my brother.
Thank you, Monty. Thank you, guys.
Absolutely. All right. So our closing song, I think it is so fitting. It is very specific. It's got some not bad language, but it's got some language. It's got some wording in it that is pretty direct. But I think it's needed to be heard. It is by Richie Supa, and it's entitled "Make a Change." Here's Mr. Supa.
Snowflakes burning in a hot glass pipe, dancing with a needle trying to get off right. Another day gone, you ain't gonna see daylight. You need a couple of grams so you try to score. Every day you have to fight another war. All you're gonna do is just fade out tonight. That's right. Time to make a change, change, change. Time to take a look. Talking about the crash and burn, you could write a book. Living for the high, 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 you became a slave. You better get yourself together while there's still enough for you to save. Time to make a change, yeah, 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 yeah. Time to make a change, yeah, 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 yeah. You put up walls between the ones you love, trying to hide the fact that you're so messed up. Only thing you feel is whatever you use today. Hey, hey. Refrigerator's empty and you can't make rent. Trying to figure out where all the money went. Life is hard enough without hurting yourself each day. Hey, hey. Time to make a change, change, change. Time to take a look. Talking about the crash and burn, you could write a book. Living for the high. Searching for answers you can't find. Cause everything you're doing keeps you blind. Don't wanna feel, so you stay high. You know your hands are tied. Yeah, you wonder why. It's time to make a change, change, change. Time to take a look. Talking about the crash and burn, you could write a book. Living for the high, high, high. One foot in the grave. You better get yourself together while there's still enough for you to say. Change, yeah, yeah, yeah,
Incredible recovery music of Mr. Richie Supa. Please visit the website recoveryunplugged.com. A very special thank you to my dear friend and brother, Freddie, for sharing his experience, strength, and hope. And listen, my friends, don't forget to subscribe to us by visiting us at take12radio.com and clicking on any of the podcasting platforms listed there. Or simply search for Take 12 Recovery Radio wherever you get your podcasts. Until our next broadcast, this is the Monty Man along with the rest of the Take 12 Recovery Radio family, and we are wishing God's perfect serenity for you.
This has been a broadcast of Take 12 Recovery Radio and KHLT Recovery Broadcasting.
Kitty, 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 kitty.
If you are seeking a residential recovery program, may I suggest the Recovery Ministry of Adult and Teen Challenge. For a center in your area, visit TeenChallengeUSA.com.
We're out.
Dude, that was cool.